Thank you. and you, it don't exist, it don't exist. What's more powerful or in control? It don't exist, it don't exist. Who else can rescue me, supply all my needs? They don't exist, they don't exist. Who else can make me whole or save my soul? They don't exist, they don't exist. 'Cause you are greater than anything.
Come on, put your hands together.
You are greater than anything.
If you believe it, come on, get on your feet wherever you are.
What's stronger than you? It don't exist, it don't exist. What's more powerful or in control? It don't exist, it don't exist. Who else can rescue me, supply all my needs? They don't exist, they don't exist. Who else can make me whole and save my soul? They don't exist. No, they don't, 'cause you are greater than anything.
That's it, come on, you are greater.
Tell you who he is to me. My healer, redeemer, strong tower, my everything, defender, way maker, my savior, my everything. Redeemer, strong.
Mouths this morning, if you know without a shadow of a doubt that the Lord is everything to you. He's life, he's breath, he's air, he's strength, he's hope, he's joy, he's peace. Then today we lift up our voices and say,
oh,
that it's my season.
It's my season.
I believe
that it's my time.
It's my time. You ought to declare that over your life.
And I can feel it.
Breakthroughs.
Breakthroughs in the room. Woo.
If you want it, yours. That God's getting ready to move. You know why? Because
I know my God is working.
Woo. He's working miracles just for you. And it's gonna be.
Today our scripture will be coming from Matthew chapter 5, verses 44 and 45. And it reads, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust." Let us pray. Most holy, all-wise God, dear Heavenly Father, let us for you, Lord, we come. Thank you for everything that you've done in our lives, Lord. Lord, ask you to walk with us and be with us as we go on another day's journey. Lord, we thank you for waking us up this morning, Lord, and starting us on this journey today, Lord, because we know it's nothing that we can do without you. Lord, ask you to continue to just walk with us and talk with us and continue to just be who we need in our lives, Lord, because without you, Lord, we can't do anything. And again, Lord, I just come to you this morning, Lord, asking that you just continue to just bless this church family. Bless the families that hear my voice, Lord. Bless each and every one that hear my voice. And Lord, I just ask that whatever they need and they desire, that you grant these things to them. For in Jesus' precious name we do pray. Amen.
Sought the Lord and he heard me and he delivered me from all of my fears. It's a good day to be alive. To God be the glory for the great things that he has done. It's offering time, and this is a time where you have the opportunity to be a sower in God's kingdom. And you do know that when you sow, you will reap a harvest of blessings, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Men will pour into your bosom. You can give through Givelify or through Cash App. Givelify is G-I-V-E-L-I-F-Y, and you will find New Hope Baptist Church, and you can give through Givelify or through Cash App. Our cash tag is $ New Hope Nation, capital N, capital H, capital N, or you can mail your gifts to 1303 Hawthorne Lane, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28205, or you can bring it and drop it in the receptacle located on the educational wing door. I am a living witness, and I believe that there are others of you with me who know you can't beat God-given no matter how you try. Help us to advance the kingdom through the ministry of New Hope Nation, and I believe God will bless you. Join us on January the 31st, 2021, the fifth Sunday of this month, as we present our first fruits offering to the Lord. We believe that God gave us the very best He had to offer, His Son, Jesus Christ. In the same way, we sacrifice the best we have for Him, bringing our first fruits to the Lord. As Proverbs 3:9 says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. We believe that as we give in faith, God will supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory. There is no set amount, but give as you believe God will bless. We pray that as you sow your first fruits, God will bring increase and abundance in your life. The annual meeting of New Hope Church will commence on Monday, February 1st, 2021 at 7 p.m. All members will be sent via email the Zoom information. If you have not updated your email in our system, please email our church clerk at nhmbcclerk@yahoo.com. That's nhmbcclerk@yahoo.com. Thank you, and please govern yourselves accordingly. We survived a challenging year last year, but God has allowed us to survive. And I believe that this is the season of rebound.
Gonna come into your own seasons, walk into your season. That you've sown, you're gonna come into your own season.
Walk into your season.
I believe we're in a time when God's gonna bless the saints, those who have stayed, those who have prayed. He's gonna fulfill the promise He made. And I hear the Spirit say, it's your time, the wait is over. Walk into your season. Gonna come.
did a lot. The return has been slow. You throw up your hands, you say, I give up. I just can't take it anymore. But I hear the Spirit say that it's your time. The wait is over. Walk into your season. Joy. I can hold my head up and walk straight into my season. The season of rebound. Woo! The season of restore. I'm walking. Ooh. Oh, yeah. Walk on. Decree it and declare it. I'm walking into my season. I'm walking into my season. Oh, walk on.
This is the year of rebound. You may have missed a shot. You may have missed opportunities. Possibilities may have faded. Your faith may have fizzled. and your dreams may have faded, but this year you will regain that which was lost.
2 seconds. One, the floater, slam down at the buzzer.
Today. Griffin throws it. Should the Spurs foul? Should Miami go for the three right away?
Just attack the basket. James catches, puts up a three. Won't go. Rebound Bosch. Back out to Allen. His three-pointer. Bang!
This is the year of the rebound. Rebound in your marriage. Rebound in your family. Rebound in your finances. God's getting ready to restore that which was lost. God be praised. God be praised. God be praised. I'm so excited to continue in this series on rebounding and God's ability to bring us back to a place that is better. That is better than it was before. After a decline, to now be on the rise, to be on the up and up. That's where we are, and that's what rebound is about. God restoring unto us not just possessions, but positions. Ooh, spiritual positions, sitting us in heavenly places, sitting us above and not beneath. Rekindling the fire and the flame and the passion and the desire. We are in the rebound. Somebody thank God for rebound this morning. Somebody just bless God that you're on your way. You're on your way to better days. That your worst days are behind you. That your best days are ahead of you. That this is the season that will catapult you into your wealthy place. Come on, somebody bless him. The devil cannot stop it. The devil cannot block it. The devil cannot reverse it. Oh, God, whatever God has set, whatever he has put in motion will be completed. It will come to pass. It will come to fruition. Somebody open your mouth right where you are. Decree and declare. And it is so in the name of Jesus. Somebody praise him right where you are. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank God for worship today and being able to share our gifts. Amen. Amen. Listen, every leader may not be able to sing. Every leader may not be able to play. Every leader may not be able to direct. Every leader may not be, but guess what? Every leader ought to be a worshiper. Every leader ought to be a worshiper. If your leader is not a worshiper, challenge them. Challenge them to be a worshiper. Put them to the test and see, and if you can engage them into worship, let them know that my leader must be a worshiper. Even if you're a warrior, you cannot be a successful warrior if you're not a successful worshiper. So I'm grateful to be able to share my gifts and to worship God with what he has given me. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Word of God this morning. I just want to talk to you for a few minutes. Listen, I'm still on a high from Bible study Wednesday night. If you didn't see our Bible study on Wednesday night, go back. You can go back and watch that video of our Bible study. Oh, my gosh. He spoke to us in such a mighty way. Thank God for all of you that are watching this morning. Those of you that are on YouTube, God bless you. We see you there. Those of you that are on Facebook Live this morning, we see you there. And we thank God for you. I would that you would go to the Old Testament book of 2 Samuel chapter 6. 2 Samuel chapter 6. Very familiar passage of scripture that I want to just kind of look at as we are dealing within the scope and the framework of rebound that I believe will help us this morning. Amen. Praise God. 2 Samuel chapter 6, I want to begin at verse number 10, reading from the English Standard Version. So David was not willing to take the ark of the Lord into the city of David, but David took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, for 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David,
the Lord had blessed the household of Obed-Edom and all that belonged to him because of the ark of the Lord. So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. And so I want to submit to you another installment today on Rebound 21. Within this, and I want to throw this out early so that you get it, because if I get happy, I may not be able to get to it. So I want to throw it out now that this particular rebound is about rethinking, reclaiming, returning, and rejoicing. It's totally not how I usually begin a sermon with the points that are usually at the end of the sermon. But I want you to get it, and I want you to write those things down, and I want you to meditate on those things and pray on those things, because a successful rebound includes rethinking, reclaiming, returning, and rejoicing. We've been looking at basketball the last 2 weeks, and I've started the sermon with a message or with a story about a basketball game. Last week, we talked about the historic basketball game with Miami Heat, San Antonio Spurs. And the week before, we talked about that. And so just in knowing about what an actual rebound is in the game of basketball, believe it or not, my brothers and sisters, even though it seems totally impulsive and it seems like you have to act on instinct in that moment, because there's not a lot of time for you to respond in the moment. But here is the reality. Within the scope and the time frame of what seems to be an impulsive moment, because it is so slow, I mean so quick, and I believe that there is included in that dynamic an impulse and almost a reflex, if you will. But incorporated in that very short moment is the opportunity to rethink, to reclaim, to return, and hopefully and ultimately rejoice. What must you do in that split second? You must rethink this entire play. How do I approach it now? Now that my teammate or the opposing team has missed the basket, it has now given me an opportunity to respond. To this moment. That missed shot has now given me an opportunity to approach with opportunity and possibility a moment that can help me score. But I cannot only think impulsively. So in the split second that I have to respond, I have to rethink this entire play, because now I'm in a different position than the person that shot the first shot. But not only do I have to rethink the play, but then I have to reclaim, in other words, take possession of the ball. Once I take possession of the ball, within this split second, all of this has to take place. Once I reclaim the ball and I take possession of it, then I have to, in faith, return to the basket. Come on, y'all. Are y'all walking with me? It's not going to take me long today. I just want to talk to you. Then I have to return to the basket. After I have rethought how I'm going to approach it, I have reclaimed and taken possession of the ball. Now, by faith, I have to return to the same hoop that somebody else just missed. And I've got to return to it with faith enough to go past the reservations and the apprehensions that could cause me to forfeit the moment because somebody else missed the shot. Come on, y'all. I need you to see beyond basketball. I need you to see life in this. Now that I have reclaimed it and I have been given the opportunity to make the shot, I cannot be afraid. I cannot allow fear to take me over in this moment, because it could risk my rejoicing. Come on, see it, and see it if you will. You got to rethink this moment. You've got to reclaim this moment. You've got to return in this moment so that you can rejoice in this moment. In our text today, we see David. He is the Lord's anointed and is getting ready to rebound from a major failure that could have cost him his whole operation. It's really important when we look at it because we've often heard that David is a man after God's own heart. He's a man whom many of us probably try to emulate. He's a man that many of us maybe try to imitate at times. But it's very important that we see exactly who this man is. He is a king. He was made the king of Israel at 30 years old. Saul has died, and immediately he is recognized as the king of Judah at that point. He waits 7 years after that. He is made the king of Israel. It's amazing because the minute that the Philistines, who are the sworn enemies of Israel, hear that David has ascended to the throne, they come to seek his life. They wait until he gets in his purposed place and his purposed position, and then they launch their attack after David. Why? Because David made an impact and left an imprint in the mind of the enemy. Don't forget, these are Philistines. Can you go back? Can you remember when David's brothers who were fighting in the army? David was not. David was a little boy. He was a shepherd boy. He was at home with his father. His father sends him to go take his brother's lunch. Y'all remember the story? He goes and he hears Goliath in the meadow, in the valley, tantalizing the Israelites' army, challenging them to send their giant to fight him, challenging them, send your best soldier, send your biggest and your baddest soldier. He hears those insults. He hears that tantalizing. He hears the challenging. And he's looking around at the others like, don't y'all hear this? Are y'all not going to do anything about this? And David is the one, the small one, the ruddy one, the shepherd boy who says, I could take him on. He's a piece of cake. And somebody overhears him, goes back and tells the king at the time that this shepherd boy, David, is talking about how he can take on this giant. And of course, he's sent for. Come on, y'all know it. The giant, the king looks at him and laughs and like, are you serious? Well, if you're going to go, take my armor. Well, the king is Saul at that time. And Saul, the Bible says, stood head and shoulders above everybody else in the kingdom. So he's a tall man. He's a big man. If anybody should have been fighting Goliath, it should have been Saul. Saul says, let me give you my armor. David says, I cannot go with those. I haven't proven those. And it wouldn't fit me anyway. You will never defeat giants wearing somebody else's armor. That's a whole nother story for a whole nother day. But somebody might have needed to hear that. You don't have to be like anybody else to be your best. Come on, walk with me for a minute. You don't have to do what other people do or have what other people have to be your best or to defeat any enemies or to take down any giants. I can't wear that. I can't go with those. You've got to be yourself. Let me tell you one thing that I have learned over the 20 years that I've been in ministry and just in living life, that I am very successful and now very comfortable at being myself. I used to try to live up to the expectations of others. I used to try to walk in a certain way and try to dress in a certain way and try to do this and try to say that. But I have come to the realization that I am my best when I am myself. Are you here? So if I want to have wild and crazy hair, I do it. If I want to wear a jean shirt instead of a robe with my doctoral bars that I earned, I wear it. Because I recognize that I am most successful at killing demons and slaying giants when I do it in my own skin. Woo! Come on here, somebody. And so, yes, it is at that point, we know the story, that David approaches and takes the challenge of Goliath, and he approaches with what? A slingshot and 5 smooth stones. He takes down Goliath with 1 stone, and it knocks him out, and then he goes and takes Goliath's sword and cuts his head off, and that's what kills him. The stone doesn't kill him. The stone knocks him down. Then he takes the sword and goes and cuts his head off. That kills him. And that made an impact on the Philistines. Now, here he is 30 years old. Then he was a boy. They wait until he ascends to the place of authority. They wait until he ascends to the place of leadership. Let me tell you something. You have made an impact on people early in your life, and there are some enemies and there are some haters that are waiting for you to get to the place of exposure. They don't want to bother you while you're still a child, while you're still ruddy, while you're still wet behind the ears. They want to wait until you are seated high and get to a place of exposure because they think they can humiliate you publicly. Woo! But the devil is a liar. The only reason they want to do it is because you've made a lasting an imprint on their life. They want to get back. They want to take revenge, and they want to do it publicly. But what they don't realize is that God has given you more strength since the last time they saw you. Are you sure now that I'm the king, you want to step to me? When the fact of the matter is, while I was a boy, I took care of a lion and a bear with my bare hands. I killed them without a sword. I killed them without a slingshot. But if you want to come, come. But just know I'm not the same person I was when you met me before. And I was bad then. Woo! Come on, I got to get to this. David made an impact and an imprint on the enemy so that the enemy would never forget him. You've got to be careful. You got to make your enemies remember so that when they come again, they will at least think twice before they launch their attack. As soon as he moves into his purpose place, that's when the enemy shows up. When he moves into that place, problems arise. And the Bible says David inquires of the Lord when we look in this text because he feels that in order for his ministry, his leadership, his governance to fit, it needs to be a place of worship. Worship needs to be restored in Jerusalem. Worship needs to be restored in the holy city. And any warrior who is a worshiper is not comfortable when the environment is not conducive to what's in them. Are y'all in the house? So let's look at what it says. And you got to go back to 1 Samuel. Stay with me. I'm almost finished. I'm going to give you my points. And then we're going to pray and be finished today. 1 Samuel 7. When you look at verse number 1 and 2, they're talking about the Ark of the Covenant. He wants to bring the Ark of the Covenant back. 1 Samuel 4 starts talking about the Ark of the Covenant. 1 Samuel 4:4, they talked about bringing the Ark of the Covenant back. It has been sent back by the Philistines, and it's placed in the house of Abinadab. For many years, it remained in Baalah. And at this point, it's been about 100 years that has gone by, and the Ark of the Covenant has been misplaced. David plans to make Jerusalem the metropolis for worship and government. So David has got to get the Ark of the Covenant back in the place of Jerusalem. He knows that this will raise Jerusalem once again as the holy city, because he knows that the Ark of the Covenant represents the very presence of God. David is a praiser, and he's got to have God's presence in the city. Whenever you're a praiser, you got to have God's presence. You are not comfortable being in a place where the presence of God is not sensed, where the presence of God is not felt. Are y'all talking to me in here? When you are a true praiser, you don't stay where the presence of God is not evident or where it is not welcome. After all, remember, this is the same David that was dancing in the meadow praising God so until his garments came off. I've got to know that the presence of God is here. Praisers long for his presence. They long for his power. And the Ark of the Covenant represented just that. When you look back at the presence of the Ark in 1 Samuel, it says that the people shouted until the earth shook because the Ark of the Covenant was in their presence. And this is the power that David wants in the holy city. The people shouted until the earth shook because the ark was present, symbolized the presence of God. And David says, I've got to go and get this. I can't lead. I can't lead. And the people cannot understand what type of leadership I bring until they recognize the power and the presence of God. For he is the only one that has sustained me to this moment. He is the only one that kept me from being destroyed. He is the only one that protected me and provided for me to even ascend to this place of privilege. Hello, somebody. And so I've got to bring the Ark of the Covenant and establish this city, not just in government, but also in spirituality. Ooh, I saw week before last a president of a country who shows us that his faith is very important and that it is also a priority. While the position of the president is important, his faith is also a priority. So that in front of millions of people, he would quote scripture, select songs that are indicative of his faith. Amazing grace. Come on, y'all. To quote that weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I don't know what Saul was doing. I don't know what Saul believed, but I believe that joy cometh in the morning. And so David says, I am not ashamed of my relationship with God, and I'm going to establish this place not just as a city but as a holy city. Are y'all talking to me in here? And so the Bible says that David gets 30,000 men. They are going and getting the Ark of the Covenant back. The Ten Commandments, the tablets are in this encasement. The rod, the budding rod of Aaron is in this encasement. It is in gold with seraphim's wings protecting it. There are holes on each corner with the poles that go through it so that the Levites can transport it from one place to the other because it's too holy for hands to touch it. I've got to get the Ark of the Covenant back. And the Bible says that 30,000 men go with David. It bears the name of God himself. You got to go back to Exodus 25 and Numbers 4. And even the Levites, who were the holies, could not touch the ark. They were not even supposed to look at it because of its power. You've got to look even now in Judaism. The name of God is never spelled out because his name is too holy for mortal mouths and mortal men to speak. They take the vowels out of the word Yahweh because your mouth is still too profane to call his name. Woo! The Bible says that they go and they seize it. They go and get it and they put it on the back of a wagon. Wait a minute. They go and seize the Ark of the Covenant, and they put it on the back of a wagon. Now, I need us to see the course of events for a minute before I get to the points, the other points, and then we're done. They go and they seize the Ark of the Covenant. They go into enemy territory, seize the Ark. They put it on the back of the wagon. Now, nobody died in putting the Ark on the wagon, which meant somebody had to know the rules. Because it seems to me that placing the ark on the wagon, if somebody touched it, they would have died then. Were the people, were the mass, were the crowd, were the 30,000 people not there to see the Ark of the Covenant be put on the wagon? And if it was being placed on the wagon and there were Levites present, did not any of the Levites say, hey, that ain't the way we're supposed to be doing this? It doesn't say that anyone said that, but it does say that they went and got the Ark of the Covenant and they put it on the back of a wagon to transport it. The Bible says that there's a great celebration, that the Ark of the Covenant is on its way back to Jerusalem. They're shouting and they're excited because they went into the enemy's camp and they seized that I'm going to the enemy's camp and I'm going to take back what he stole from me. And the Bible says that along the way, an oxen stumbled and threatened to throw the Ark off the cart. And Uzzah reaches out to grab it. And when he reaches out to grab it, his hand touches. All he wants to do is protect it. All he wants to do is save it. All he wants to do is keep it from falling. And he reaches out to grab it. And God strikes him dead in that moment. He was innocent. He was just trying to be helpful. And God kills him in front of everybody. 30,000 people are shouting in the street. 30,000 people are dancing. Everybody's excited. We are finally going to get the Ark of the Covenant. The enemy had it, and they didn't appreciate it because they didn't know what it was worth. And we know what it's worth, but we put it on the back of a wagon pulled by an ox. We know what it's worth. It's the presence of God. It's the power of God. And we're walking with it, and we're celebrating. We know what it's worth, but it's on the back of a wagon pulled by an ox. When there are strict stipulations as to how the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to be transported. And David is a worshiper, and David has a relationship with God. And there are Levites in his presence, and the Ark is on the back of a wagon drawn by an ox. Bible says that along the way, they're passing an outcropping of stone, a threshing place belonging to Nacon, and the ox stumbled, threatening to throw the ark off. And instinctively, Uzzah lays hold of it and dies. See, here's the reality. The reality is, if you're going to do it, you got to do it God's way. Let me say that again before I finish, before I close. If you're going to do it, you got to do it God's way. It has to be done in a sacred manner. And even if you have good intentions, you can't allow your intentions to cause you to deviate from God's plan. Your intentions cannot cause you to deviate from God's instructions. Let me say that again so you can get that. Your intentions cannot cause you to deviate from God's instructions. God has requirements, and God will not renege on the requirements he has set. Let me tell you why you cannot put the Ark of the Covenant on the back of a wagon. Here is the thing. Not just because the Levites are supposed to carry it, but because he wants you to feel the weight. Come on, stay with me. He wants you to feel the weight of his glory. That ark represents the very presence of God. And the thing is, you want to win, but you don't want to carry the weight. You don't mind being in worship as long as somebody else carries the weight. Let me tell you something. There are some people, even in this season right now, and I'm going to finish, even in this season right now, who are just loving this, who are loving the fact, and I'm glad that we're able to stay connected, that we're able to stay together, that we're able to be able to have worship even on a virtual plane. But there are some who are comfortable. There are some who are relaxed. Because, of course, we can't have a whole lot of people gathering right now during this pandemic. So we'll just work the very few that are doing it. And I'm good. I can lay back and chill. Y'all go ahead. Let the camera crew work. Let the musicians sing, play. Let the musicians sing. Whoever's there, let them do it. I ain't got to do nothing but lay back and watch. So we don't mind worshiping, but we do mind sometimes carrying the weight. The weight, God says, I want you to feel the weight of my glory so that you appreciate it. If you put my presence on the back of a wagon that is drawn by an ark, you never feel the weight of my glory, the weight of my presence. Here's the thing, that my yoke is easy and my burdens are light, but you've got to feel this so you know how valuable it is to you, so that you recognize that you have a vested interest in this moment. This moment, I feel the weight of his presence, and the weight of his glory reminds me of the worth. If I can carry his glory, then I can take his yoke, for his yoke is easy and his burdens are light. And so the question becomes, are you willing to carry the weight? Here is the thing. There were Levites in the presence of what was going on, and none of the Levites are recorded saying, this ain't the way we're supposed to do it. Did they not want to carry it anymore? Were they lazy in this moment? Were they glad there was an ox and there was a wagon? Whoo! This gives us a few minutes so that we can rest, so that we can chill. No, if you want the presence of God, you've got to be willing to carry the weight of his glory. You want to feel something? something. You've got to be willing to give something. Help us in this house this morning. You cannot sit back and let somebody else do it and then you soak up all the benefits. No, you've got to be willing to say, God, I'm willing to carry it. Lay it on me, whatever it is. I will carry just so I can feel you, just so I can hear you, just so I can know that you're in our midst. Ooh. Bible says at that moment, Uzzah dies and David gets mad. He gets upset at that moment because it did not work like he thought and wanted it to. God, you let me take 30,000 men, go into Philistine territory, claim back what was taken from us. I rethought this whole thing. I rethought how I was going to do it. Come on. I gave you the points, right? I rethought this whole thing. I didn't just impulsively approach this moment. I came up with a strategy as to how we were going to return, how many I would take so that others would be intimidated, so they would fear, because there's unity and there's strength, and the strength of us displays the might of us. I rethought this whole thing. I didn't just wake up one day and say, oh, I'm gonna do this. No, it took time for me to re-strategize. And now I have reclaimed that which was taken, and this happens? How many of us know what it's like to strategize and to plan and to rethink things and to reclaim stuff and it still doesn't work like we thought it was? And just like David, many of us get upset. We get mad. We get an attitude and we walk away. We get upset. We get mad because our plan didn't work. Oh my God. We get upset. We get angry. Here's the thing. I had to let this moment happen so that everyone would know that no one is above correction. And that you make mistakes, but you got to live long enough to show your critics that there's life after your mistakes. Oh my God. Bible says David discards the ark. The very thing that he went for, the very thing that he strategized and rethought and reclaimed, he rid himself of it. How quickly are we ready to throw our blessings away because they don't come like we think they're coming? It's in your possession, it's in your hand, but it ain't working like you want to work it, so you get rid of it. You get upset and you ditch the blessing. You ditch your deliverance. You ditch the thing that will bring you what you've been waiting for. You get rid of it. Ooh. Don't ditch your blessing. Don't ditch your blessing. Bible says that David ditches the ark and it ends up at Obed-Edom's house. And the Bible says that Obed-Edom's house was blessed for 3 months. David ditched the ark. It ends up in Obed-Edom's house. He makes the mistake of throwing it away because he attached a curse to what was blessed. And he got rid of it because it didn't do what he wanted it to do in the moment. And we are scared of it now because we can't control it. Woo! And whatever we can't control, we get rid of, or we rid ourselves. If I can't control it and manipulate it and do what I wanted to do in the moment, I either ditch it or I ditch. Woo! The Bible says everything in Obed-Edom's house was blessed. And the Bible says that when David heard it, I'm sure Obed said, thank you for getting rid of it because my whole house is blessed. You've got to make sure you understand the magnitude of the blessing of God on your life and the mandate to be obedient so that the blessing on your life is not misinterpreted. They misinterpret the moment and now Obed-Edom is blessed. Because God allowed it, because David shouldn't have been so quick to ditch the ark. 3 months he's blessed. And David gets word and gets excited because then he remembers what the ark meant. Here is where the rebound takes place. The rebound takes place because in this moment, even though he rethought and he reclaimed, he could not return until he remembered. I left that one out. on purpose because I wanted to get to this moment. Are you here? Let's go home. He had to remember the worth and remember the value of the glory of God. Wait a minute. He hears that Obed-Edom's house is blessed. Well, how does faith come? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. He heard that Obed-Edom's house was blessed, that everything, every person in his house under that roof was blessed. He had more than he ever had before. And that's when David remembered that this moment was not about his failure. Ooh. It was about the future of Israel. Ooh. This moment is so much bigger than my emotional breakdown. This moment is so much bigger than my temper tantrum. This moment is so much bigger than my attitude. This moment is so much bigger than my being disgruntled. I hope I'm helping somebody hear it, see it. It's much bigger than my pain. It's about God's plan and God's purpose for our life. David got excited because he remembered what it meant. And when you're a true praiser, and when it's in you, here it is. You might ditch it for a moment, but you ain't gonna ditch it for a lifetime. When it's in you, you may get into your feelings for a minute, but after a while, feelings have got to shift because faith kicks in, because fire kicks in, and because you recognize what kind of future has already been established for you. So you may ditch it for a minute, but after a while, you're going back to get it. You're gonna return to the place where you first believed. You're going to return to the place of your fire. You're going to return to the place of your passion. Even if you get upset, you don't allow a moment of temporary dissatisfaction to ruin your destiny. Let me say it again. You don't allow a moment of temporary dissatisfaction to ruin your destiny. And the Bible says that David goes back and gets the Ark of the Covenant. Somebody shout rebound. He goes back and gets it because he remembers. He goes back and gets it because he remembers who God is. And he remembers what God had done. And he says, we got to go back and get it. I recognize what this moment was about. This moment is to let us know that we can live beyond our mistakes. And when we live beyond them, we come at it another way. Woo. David goes back, gets the Ark of the Covenant. And this time, somebody shout this time. This time he does it exactly how he knew it was supposed to be done in the first place. Yes, I got an attitude because one of my men died. And most of the time when we make mistakes, nobody has to die. A lot of times nobody even knows about it. But it's another level when what we do affects somebody else. And somebody else's life is on the line because of a mistake that we make. Lord, I don't mind you. I make my mistake, but just me. But if somebody else's line, life is on the line. And that's why you've got to understand how important your anointing and your calling is and your assignment is, because there are people who are watching you and there are people who are depending on you. And you do not realize that sometimes our slips and our mess up will mess up somebody else's salvation, will mess up somebody else's perspective. Hello, somebody. That's why the Bible says, if eating meat offend your brother, don't eat meat, because they may not be able to process the moment, and then that blood is on your hands. He made a mistake and somebody lost their life. But what he had to realize is there is a way to bounce back, to rebound from that moment, recognizing and understanding that God never takes everything. So then what does he do? He has to realize that, boom, God took one to be the example, but he didn't kill everybody. If he wanted to, he could have killed all 30,000 of them. He could have killed David because David was the one responsible, and he could have let everybody else live, but he only takes one and leaves him with 29,000, so that if by chance there are any enemies who try to come back and take what belonged to you, you still have enough left to fight with. Oh God, there's another sermon in itself. You still have enough to fight with, even though you made a mistake, even though you messed up, even though you didn't do it God's way in the first place. He will still give you enough to fight with. I need you to nudge somebody in your house. If not, just put it in the comments, whether you're on YouTube or Facebook, and let them know, yes, I messed up, but I still got something to fight with. Woo! I fell and I faltered, but I still got something to fight with. Please don't step. Don't come at me the wrong way. Yes, I know that I was not perfect. Yes, we've sinned and come short of the glory of God, but I still got something to fight with. He left him 29,000 men to take the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. Why? Because that's the kind of God that he served, and that's who he remembered. Woo! David gets excited. He learns from this mistake and he honors God's requirement. The Bible says he gathers all of the men and goes and gets the Ark of the Covenant, and now he's got more excitement. When they bear the Ark of the Covenant, he sacrificed in verse number 14. And the Bible says that he does something that's totally out of his character as a king, but not out of character as a kid. The Bible says he starts dancing in the street because he recognizes, now I'm doing it God's way. He tells the Levites, get your poles, put them through those rings, and carry this ark. Feel the weight of his glory. Feel the weight of his presence. Let it bear down on you so you recognize how valuable his word is. So you recognize how valuable his will is. Carry it. Somebody shout, carry it. Carry it to your place of destiny. Carry it to your place of promise. Carry it to your purposed place. Carry it. He says they're carrying the ark now the way God wanted it to do. And he dances in the street with all his might. He has on his linen ephod, and the Bible says that the people are returning in victory. They are returning. Sure, I'm sure they had time. 3 months went by. They have time to mourn Uzzah. They have time to rethink what they did. They had time to re-strategize. But at this time and at this moment, return is taking place, because God will give you the ability as well as the root of your return. He'll open the door for you. He'll open your mind. He'll open your eyes. He'll give you new perspective. He'll give you new vision. But not only that, he'll renew your strength. He'll renew your joy so that you're able to return in victory, so that you're able to return in praise. You're able to return in worship, declaring that I lost something on the way, but what I gained is more than what I lost. He's shouting and dancing in the street, and he's so caught up that he fails to realize that his wife is at home when he gets into the city, watching how he's dancing in the streets. And she's very offended by what she sees. The Bible says when David gets into the city, he offers offerings and he blessed the people in the name of the Lord. The people received the blessing because the leader received the blessing. You should want your leader to be blessed, because when your leader is blessed, you're blessed. Because the leader was blessed, he blessed the people. That's a whole nother sermon on a whole nother day. You can't hate on your leader for being blessed. You should want your leader to be blessed so that the people can be blessed. He gave them bread and flesh and wine, and he goes home to bless his wife and to bless his own house, and he's met with rejection. She's looking at the flesh, hello, and not at the spirit, and says, oh, you're out there dancing in front of all the women until your clothes came off. Isn't that nice for the king to do? My husband. And it's at that moment. It is at that moment, the moment where he's rejoicing because of this return, that the enemy uses his wife to try to take his focus and to steal this moment. He's rejoicing and she's shouting. He's shouting, and this is what she says. But rebound had already taken place in the field. Now rebound has to take place in his house. How's he going to respond to this moment? If rebound has been effective, then you will respond in a different way. So what does he do? Of course, he tells her, look, the Lord chose me. I'm the one. He didn't choose your father. Your father couldn't do it. Woo! Now, there was a little, where's my Bible study people? To some, that might have sounded a little petty. But he does, in a way, say, the Lord chose me to bring the Ark of the Covenant back. Your father was the king. Did he do it? Hello? Did he do it? No, I don't think so. And if you think that you what you saw was something, hold my mule and watch me praise him even harder. I'll do it the more. If that offended you, you ain't seen nothing. Here are the points that I want to give you, and then I'm finished. Rebound was revealed in the attitude and the realization that David had. Rebound was revealed in the realization that David had. First, he had to remember the value and the worth. But here's what rebound was revealed through. It was revealed through, number one, that the moment he experienced was more about God's mercy than it was about his mistake. He thought about the mercy of God more than he did the mistake that he made. He says, I lost somebody trying to bring this thing back, but God didn't let my mistake cancel my mission. Woo! He didn't let my mistake cancel my mission. I made some mistakes, but my mistake didn't abort the mission. Hallelujah. Come on, I feel something right there. He knew I was headed somewhere, and his mercy showed up. And David said, the reason I'm dancing is because mercy showed up. Because mercy makes sure you don't get what you deserve. I'm dancing, and I dance because my experience was about God's mercy and not my mistake. We make mistakes, but we don't end bitter. We end better even after the mistake. And so that I don't wear the garment of demotion, I wear the garment of praise. Come on, somebody. I need somebody to start shouting right where you are, because you recognize that your mistake was not to kill you, but it was to develop you, and that your moment was more about God's mercy than it was your mistake. I need some help in this house. I know you probably wanted, ain't he all right? But I really want you to get this, and I want you to hear this, because somebody, wherever you are, needs to know that your mistake will not destroy you. God wants to show you that he has mercy, and his mercy is rich. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning, morning by morning. New mercies I see. Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. I just want to thank you and praise you too. Your grace and mercy brought me through. Somebody ought to thank God for mercy even in your mistake. God showed you mercy. But the second reason is why he danced was because he realizes in this rebound that God's condemnation was not to kill him. What do you mean? What I mean is this. Condemnation was not God's correction. You're looking at me dancing thinking it's a flesh party, but there's a lot behind this. I'm dancing because he didn't condemn me, even though he corrected me. Oh, God. He did not condemn me, even though he corrected me. And some would rather condemn me than correct me. There are some who come to church looking for somebody to condemn instead of somebody to correct. But the God I serve is not into condemning. He's into correcting. He chastens those that he loves, and he will help me recover from my mistake. And I'm able to recover because he doesn't condemn me. He corrects me. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to those who walk uprightly. Those who walk not after the flesh, what? But after the Spirit. I rebound, and in my rebound, I discovered that his correction is not condemnation. And I'm so glad that God ain't like church folks, because they would have sent him to hell. You know, that's your fault. That man died. It's your fault. The blood on your hands. He recognizes that it's not about condemnation. It's about correction. But here is the ultimate thing about his rebound that he can appreciate. He understood that God made sure in that moment that he would be remembered for finishing and not failing. Ooh. I said, God made this moment of rebound so he would be remembered for finishing and not failing. David, you're a man after my God's own heart. You served Saul, and even when he was trying to kill you, now you've ascended into leadership. And one thing I will make sure that people do is remember that you finished. They will not see your failure. They will see you as one who finished, because God has a way of helping you finish even when you don't think you can. I'm going to give you a strong finish because you had a strong faith. You're going to finish strong. I know about you, but I believe you can finish, because the race isn't given to the swift nor to the strong, but the one that endures until the end. And because I have begun a good work in you, it shall be performed until the day of Jesus Christ. I don't plan on failing, but I plan on finishing. And God can give me what I need to finish. The God I serve will not let me fail in the face of my enemies. Somebody's waiting for you to fail. Waiting for you to fall, by the way. But the God I serve is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything you can ask or think. Don't you worry, don't you fret, you're going to finish. It will be completed, every dream, every goal. You're going to finish. I'm not scared. I'm not ashamed. He's done too much for me to be worrying about offending others because of my behavior. David says, God chose me to appoint me as the ruler of Israel. He chose me. He chose me. I was the baby of the family. I was an adulterer with you. But he chose me. Woo! Your father was the one, but he chose me. Even when I didn't think I could do it anymore. And you think I'm going to let you stop me from giving God praise? When I see what he's been able to do in the midst of my mistakes? He says, I'll do it worse than this. I'll dance through my mistake. I'll dance through my correction. That's how David rebounded. Now, brothers and sisters, I don't care where you are in life. I don't care what type of mistakes you make. I don't care if you get into your feelings, you get an attitude, and you start ditching stuff and throwing stuff away, or you start removing yourself from the situation. God will help you to remember. That's why you need the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is what brings things back to our remembrance. Remember that he's a holy God. Remember that he's a loving God. Remember that he's a forgiving God. And he'll give you the ability to finish, and people will see that instead of your failure. David says, my sin is ever before you. I've sinned, and it's ever before you. It's ever before me. But God says, I'll make sure that the people see that you finished. That you had a job, that you had a mission, that you had a ministry, and you did it. And it was not by power, come on, of yourself. It was not by your own strength. It was not by your own knowledge, even though you rethought it. Hello? You rethought it, and you returned, and you restructured, and you did all of those things. You reclaimed it. But the rejoicing happened after you remembered who I was. David had a major rebound in a major moment that could have cost him his life. But God gave him the ability to bounce back. He brought the glory back. He brought the presence back. He brought the power back. The people are dancing in the street. They're shouting, not even realizing because what God allowed them to see was not everything that God allowed David to experience. You see my glory, but you don't know my story. Today I speak rebound over your life, wherever you are. Whatever you've been through, wherever you failed, wherever you messed up, wherever you made a mistake, I speak rebound over your life. I speak a return to the glory. And I speak rejoicing over your life. I come against sorrow. I come against depression. I come against guilt. Hallelujah. Hallelujah in the name of Jesus. And I speak the spirit of rejoicing. I speak the spirit of joy over your life. I speak the spirit of peace over your life. I bind the hand of the enemy that would try to make you forget who God is and what God has done in your life. And I pray now that the spirit of God overtake you so that you realize that rebound is yours. In the name of Jesus, go back and get it. Go back and get it. You ditched it. It didn't work. You got upset. You got anything. Go back and get it. Because it's still blessing. There's still power in it. Get it. Go back and get it. Purpose is still there. It still applies. I open the door of the church for whoever you are. Today is the day. If you want to reach out to us, inbox us now, even while we're on. Inbox us now. If you're on YouTube, put it in the comments or find us on Facebook, whatever you can. Find us, email us, inbox us. Let somebody know today is the day. You're ready for your rebound. You're turning around. You're ready to walk into your purpose, to walk into your calling, to walk into your destiny. This moment is about your future, not your failure. It's about finishing. It's about finishing strong. I want to pray with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we love you. We thank you. We praise you for all that you've done, for who you are to us, what you mean to us. God, I pray now in the name of Jesus that somebody who's heard this message is not just convicted, but converted. We pray, oh God, that somebody will hear and that faith will come. Faith to change their life, faith to change their mind. I pray in the name of Jesus that salvation comes to someone's house today. Have your way in their life. Have your way in their mind. Give them the strength to keep going, the courage to keep fighting. Because you've left us something to fight with. You've left us something to work with. You didn't take everything. And you gave us the best that you had to offer, and that was your only begotten Son. And whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We love you, God, and we thank you today for what you've done and for this word and how it has ministered to us today. I pray that it's falling on good ground and in due season bring forth fruit that will be a blessing to all of us. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters. I hope that you've been blessed today by this word. I hope that it has encouraged you. I hope that it has empowered you and reminded you that rebound is yours. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. Go in peace. Let's pray together. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us henceforth, now and forever. Amen. God bless you, and I'll see you next week.